Good evening, and welcome to the inaugural conference of the Donald R. Keough School of Global Affairs. My name is Scott Appleby, and I'm honored to be the Marilyn Keough Dean of the Keough School. The first new school or college established at Notre Dame in nearly a century, the Keough School aspires to become a recognized world leader in globally oriented research, teaching, and the education of professionals dedicated to advancing sustainable development, the alleviation of poverty, good governance, and the peaceful transformation of violent conflict. Notre Dame has never been shy in endeavoring to do great things with the dedicated people and plentiful resources that God has blessed this place with. Drawing on these resources and learning from our accomplished colleagues elsewhere in the academy, in business, in government, and public service, we at Notre Dame seek to become a force for good, not only in this nation, as Father Sorin foresaw, but in a world beset by multiple crises and threats to human dignity and human flourishing. To the extent that we succeed, we will be helping to realize the vision and ambition of Notre Dame's 17th president, the Reverend John I. Jenkins of the Congregation of Holy Cross. That's why I'm very pleased to introduce Father John, who will give you a formal welcome to this conference.
Thank you very much, Scott, and it's my genuine pleasure to welcome such a distinguished group of scholars, church leaders, and public servants to this important conference. No issues are more challenging, perhaps, and pressing than those you will discuss in coming days. Care for the Earth's environment, alleviating extreme poverty, and achieving sustainable development. And Scott has assembled such a formidable group of thought leaders to grapple with these questions. Of course, for us at Notre Dame, a Catholic university, the conference has a special significance as a response to Pope Francis's prophetic encyclical, Laudato Si. For those of us who share our Catholic faith, the Pope reminds us that that faith calls us to restore the harmony of three relationships: with God, with our neighbor, and with the earth, our common home. We're not to have dominion over the earth in the sense of being an exploiter, but as its stewards, we're charged to till and keep it, as the book of Genesis says. We must learn to do this better. The encyclical, however, is addressed not simply to those who share a Christian or Catholic faith, but to, quote, every person living on this planet to stimulate a dialogue about our common home, unquote. In a world where differences in faith often lead to conflict and destruction, this dialogue draws us together as one human family in conversation about our common home. Let us make this conference a shining example of how this dialogue about our world can draw us together in solidarity and common commitment. An adequate response to the challenges before us will demand the very best science and technological innovation available. It must call on experts to develop sophisticated and effective policies at the national and global level. It must influence governments and key institutions around the world. Yet it also must address the deeper moral, spiritual, and theological questions about who we are individually and collectively, and what we want to be together. And while we must take time to withdraw and reflect, there must be a bias for action to address the urgent matters before us. I cannot think of a more challenging or exciting dialogue. I will be with you later in the week, but you will see me slip out here very soon because I just returned from Beijing, China, and I'm worried that if I sat down in one of those seats, I will immediately fall asleep. My sleep patterns are a bit off. But I will leave you with one image. On the day we arrived in Beijing, the pollution had reached a very high rate, so that the children in the schools were not allowed to go outdoors for recess. I'm told that this is not an uncommon occurrence in that city, but it is a disturbing image. We live in a world in which environmental deterioration had reached a point the children cannot go out to play. Let us find a way to enable the children of this world to go out to play. Thank you. You all will be in my prayers in coming days.
Thank you, Father John. We dubbed this inaugural conference For the Planet and the Poor to underscore the convergence of three world historical events. The first is the promulgation of Laudato Si on care for our common home, Pope Francis's bracing, widely discussed and debated encyclical, calling for nothing less than an ecological conversion of all peoples and nations in response to a global crisis precipitated, the Pope argues, by the intertwined dilemmas of rapid environmental degradation and unjust global economic practices, both of which take their largest toll on the poor. The second world historical event is the adoption by the United Nations and the world governments it represents of the Sustainable Development Goals, an ambitious and comprehensive agenda to end poverty in all its forms everywhere, eliminate hunger, ensure healthy lives, promote inclusive and sustainable economic growth, build peaceful and inclusive societies, provide access to justice for all, and build effective, accountable, and inclusive institutions at all levels. And here, I mention only 7 of the 16 SDGs. And for the sake of brevity, I include the Paris Climate Agreements within this category of remarkable steps forward. I mentioned 3 world historical events occurring at approximately the same time. The third, of course, is the founding of the Keough School. Don't laugh. Don't scoff. Yes, it may be true that neither Pope Francis nor the United Nations is yet aware of the establishment of the Keough School, much less of its world historical importance. But in fairness, we don't officially open for another 16 months. That gives us 1 month for each of the 16 sustainable development goals to devise that expertise. And if it is true that we are not yet known by Pope Francis, the United Nations, or by all of the leading policy experts and Nobel laureates in the developing world, I'd like you to take a glance at the 3 gentlemen seated at this table, each of whom is well positioned to carry our little light abroad. And the lady on our program tonight is already totally immersed in the crucial task of building the bridges and establishing the networks that will ease the Keough School into the exciting global conversation about sustainable development. Indeed, on our program tonight, Bishop Marcelo Sánchez Sorondo is a close associate and friend of Pope Francis. Ordained a priest in Buenos Aires in 1968, he studied philosophy at the University of Perugia, and then earned the PhD in Sacred Theology summa cum laude from the Angelicum, the Pontifical University of St. Thomas Aquinas in Rome. From 1976 to 1998, he was professor and for a time a dean in the history of philosophy at the Pontifical Lateran University in Rome. From 1998 to 2013, he was full professor of the history of philosophy at Libera Università Maria Santissima Assunta in Rome. In 1998, he was appointed president of the degree course in education science. In 1998, Pope John Paul II appointed Father Marcelo Chancellor of the Pontifical Academy of the Sciences and Chancellor of the Pontifical Academy of Social Sciences, and in 1999, Secretary of the Pontifical Academy of St. Thomas Aquinas. Pope John Paul ordained him a bishop in 2001. Bishop Marcelo is the recipient of many awards, including high honors by the governments of France, Italy, Spain, Austria, and Chile. In 2011, Pope Benedict XVI made him a member of the Pontifical Commission for Latin America. His list of academic publications in several languages is truly staggering. His early work centered around the idea of participation in the core theological approach of St. Thomas, especially with regard to the crucial point of the question of the participation of man in the divine nature. In several venues, he placed both Aristotle and Aquinas in dialogue with modern philosophers, not least Hegel, especially addressing the concept of human freedom and what Bishop Marcelo calls realized freedom in history, culture, and religions. More recently, his publications have addressed the ethics of science and the dynamics of globalization, featuring titles such as Food Needs of the Developing World in the Early 21st Century, Intergenerational Solidarity, Globalization, Justice, and Charity, A Catholic Vision of the Economy, and Globalization and Terrorism. We are honored by your presence and participation here this evening, Bishop Marcelo. Our Keough School Ambassador to the United Nations is Jeffrey D. Sachs, a world-renowned economics professor, leader in sustainable development, senior UN advisor, influential author, consultant to governments, and syndicated columnist. Professor Sachs serves as the director of the Earth Institute, the Quetelet Professor of Sustainable Development and Professor of Health Policy and Management at Columbia University. He has authored 5 widely influential books just in the last decade: The End of Poverty, Commonwealth, Economics for a Crowded Planet, The Price of Civilization, To Move the World, JFK's Quest for Peace, and a key text for our conference, The Age of Sustainable Development, that was published last year. Sachs is the co-recipient of the 2015 Blue Planet Prize, the leading global prize for environmental leadership. A recent survey by The Economist ranked him among the world's most influential living economists. His work on ending poverty, overcoming macroeconomic instability, promoting economic growth, fighting hunger and disease, and promoting sustainable environmental practices has taken Jeff to more than 125 countries and more than 90% of the world's population. For more than 30 years, he has advised and been honored by dozens of heads of state and governments on economic strategy in the Americas, Europe, Asia, Africa, and the Middle East. He was among the outside advisors to Pope John Paul II on the encyclical Centesimus Annus, and in recent years, he has worked closely with the Pontifical Academy of Sciences and the Pontifical Academy of Social Sciences on the issue of sustainable development, including the discussions that helped to shape Laudato Si. Jeff's pioneering ideas on investing in health to break the poverty trap in Africa have been widely applied throughout the continent. The Millennium Villages Project, which he directs, operates in 10 African countries and covers more than 500,000 people. The MVP has achieved notable successes in raising agricultural production, reducing children stunting, and cutting child mortality rates, with the results described in several peer-reviewed publications. Its key concepts of integrated rural development to achieve the MDGs are now being applied at national scale in Nigeria and Mali, and are being used by many other countries to help support national anti-poverty programs. Following the adoption of the Millennium Development Goals in 2000, Professor Sachs became perhaps the leading academic scholar and practitioner on the MDGs. He chaired the WHO Commission on Macroeconomics and Health, which played a pivotal role in scaling up the financing of healthcare and disease control in low-income countries. He worked with UN Secretary General Kofi Annan to design and launch the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, TB, and Malaria, and worked closely with senior officials of the George W. Bush administration to develop the PEPFAR program to fight HIV/AIDS and the PMI to fight malaria. On behalf of Secretary General Kofi Annan from 2002 to 2006, he chaired the UN Millennium Project, which was tasked with developing a concrete action plan to achieve the MDGs. The UN General Assembly adopted the key recommendations of the UN Millennium Project at a special session in September 2005. In August 2012, UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon announced the launch of the UN Sustainable Development Solutions Network, with Sachs as the director. The network mobilizes scientific and technical expertise from academia, civil society, and the private sector in support of sustainable development problem solving at local, national, and global scales. Rounding out our trio of distinguished visitors is Dr. Atiq Rahman, a prominent environmentalist, scientist, development expert, and visionary thinker in South Asia. He is well known worldwide for his pioneering role and contribution to environment and nature conservation, climate change, poverty alleviation, and sustainable development. He was honored with the highest UN Environmental Award, the Champion of the Earth for the year 2008, in recognition of his outstanding and inspirational leadership and contribution globally, regionally, nationally, and locally to the protection and sustainable management of the Earth's environment and natural resources. As lead author of the fourth assessment of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, he was a co-recipient of the Nobel Peace Prize of 2007, jointly awarded to the IPCC and Al Gore. Dr. Rahman holds a PhD in industrial and applied chemistry from Brunel University of West London. The executive director of the Bangladesh Center for Advanced Studies, he has transformed this NGO into a leading think tank on environment resource management and sustainable development issues. With his national and international experience in environment and resource management, Dr. Rahman's expertise remains vital throughout the Asia-Pacific region and beyond as he helps to raise awareness of the hazards of global warming. Dr. Rahman is the convener of the Climate Action Network, South Asia, and the coordinator of the Global Forum on the Environment and Poverty. He has been a consultant to the World Bank, the Asian Development Bank, UNDP, UNICEF, UNESCO, and many national governments, and several national and international NGOs. He's published over 100 papers in international journals and books on environmental and solid-state chemistry, environmental planning and impact assessment, and renewal energy technology and policy. Titles include Sustainable Development and Climate Change, Prospects for Effective Global Governance, and Mainstreaming Adaptation to Climate Change in Least Developed Countries. Last but not least of our panelists is my colleague, Sara Sievers, who serves as Associate Dean for Policy and Practice at the Keough School. Formerly Senior Director at Columbia University's Earth Institute, she has extensive experience in advocacy, policy, and governance issues pertaining to development. More recently, she advised the government of Nigeria on implementing the Millennium Development Goals. Sievers has led global health and advocacy efforts at the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, served in the Foreign Service, and was founding executive director of Harvard University's Center for Global Development and the Earth Institute's Center for Globalization and Development. She holds an MBA from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Before I ask each of these distinguished individuals to address you, a final word from me about this surprising convergence, this moment of opportunity. The Keough School takes its mission and its inspiration from the other two world historical events I mentioned, and we hope to do our modest part to advance both Catholic social teaching and the Sustainable Development Goals. While this conference emphasizes the convergences and complementarities between the efforts of the United Nations and the Catholic Church to end poverty and preserve our natural environment, I want to acknowledge the serious and fundamental differences which remain between the Church's teaching on human life and human dignity on the one hand, and the diverse array of views, convictions, and practices represented within the member states and bureaucracy of the United Nations. These disagreements center on questions of grave moral concern for both the Church and the world, and thus they are not to be minimized. Many serious Catholics are both mindful of these fundamental disagreements and still committed to engagement, dialogue, and collaboration with those who share a calling to stand in active solidarity with the poor and marginalized, and those who suffer grievously from the depletion and pollution of nature's vast bounty. It is this spirit of constructive and critical engagement, dialogue, and collaboration toward the common good which animates the Keough School. We take our bearings and our mission from the concept of integral human development. In his address to the United Nations on September 25, 2015, Pope Francis on 7 occasions used the term integral human development as the comprehensive goal to be embraced by all people of goodwill who seek the common good of humankind. The Holy Father declared that with respect to the newly adopted sustainable development goals, quote, the simplest and best measure and indicator of the implementation of the new agenda for development will be effective, practical, and immediate access on the part of all to essential material and spiritual goods, housing, dignified and properly remunerated employment, adequate food and drinking water, religious freedom, and more generally, spiritual freedom and education. These pillars of integral human development have a common foundation, which is the right to life and more generally what we would call the right to existence of human nature itself. Close quote. Moments later, acknowledging the central role of conflict prevention and peace building, the Pope added, war is the negation of all rights and a dramatic assault on the environment. If we want true integral human development for all, we must work tirelessly to avoid war between nations and between peoples. While observing that peace and development go hand in hand, Pope Francis also recognized that little progress in these arenas can be expected in the absence of effective governance and robust political institutions. Our world demands of all government leaders, he declared, quote, a will which is effective and practical and constant and which takes concrete steps and immediate measures for preserving and improving the natural environment and thus putting an end as quickly as possible to the phenomenon of social and economic exclusion with its baneful consequences, close quote. We need to ensure, he continued, quote, that our institutions are truly effective in the struggle against all these scourges. But just what is integral human development? What are the implications for a school that would heed the church's call and build its curriculum, teaching, research, and service on this intellectual and moral foundation? What does it mean for integral human development to be at the core of the Keough School of Global Affairs mission? And how can the Keough School's understanding of integral human development benefit the larger development community? Let me offer a concise definition of integral human development. The state of a society in which the irreducible dignity of the human person and the cultural and spiritual, as well as economic and material requirements of human flourishing are central to political and social life and upheld by the rule of law. Integral human development is of, at least the term, is of Catholic prominence, but the ideas and values underlying it find echoes in many other religious, philosophical, and wisdom traditions. At its core is the conviction that the dignity of the human person is expressed in work and economic activity, but also in cultural richness, artistic creativity, religious belonging, and spiritual practice. More profoundly, human dignity is expressed in our relationship with and obligations to family, community, and all of humanity. In his encyclical on the development of peoples, Populorum Progressio in 1967, Pope Paul VI presented the concept of integral human development as a good in itself, and also as a critique of narrowly empirical and understandings of the human person and human experience. The concept was also offered as a corrective to a world overly focused on the accumulation of material wealth alone. Subsequent popes, including John Paul II and Benedict XVI, elaborated the concept. Catholic Relief Services takes it as its framework and mission. There are 5 major criteria implied for the Keough School in adopting the integral human development as our mission and conceptual framework. First, the Keough School specializes in development that takes into account each individual person as well as the society at large, and that privileges the whole person who cannot be reduced to a function, number, social category, or imposed identity. Each person is understood not only as the site of material needs, or the consumer of goods, or the citizen political subject, or the creator and bearer of culture, or the inheritor of a particular history, social identity, and set of relationships, or the member of a religious community or a voluntary network. Rather, each person is understood as the nexus of all these complex, overlapping, and co-imbricated dimensions of human life. The human person is an integral, that is, interdependent, connected being striving for wholeness, that is, for the integration of body, spirit, mind, and community. Similarly, an approach to development that avoids an exclusive focus on narrowly technical solutions or material conditions also recognizes that the concrete challenges confronting human dignity and flourishing, political oppression, deadly conflict, climate change, structural injustice, grinding poverty, are themselves interrelated and impervious to isolated solutions. Accordingly, the Keough School must incorporate into its research and teaching as consistently and robustly as possible the various disciplines, humanities and law, as well as the sciences, art, architecture, and engineering, and strive to bring these disciplines into direct and systematic conversation and collaboration. Second, taking into account the requirements of dignity and the just demands of all members of society, development, with its focus on economic and material conditions, must not be isolated from the related political and social context and needs that determine its ultimate efficacy. This capacious understanding of development is required if it is to be integral and fully human. Practically for the Keough School, this means that we are guided by a synoptic vision that understands economic development, peace building, advocacy of human rights, and good governance to be inseparable, integral dimensions of the same enterprise. Our students must learn from us how to see problems and their solutions in their complex interdependence. Peace building, for example, cannot be taught or practiced in its own silo or closed guild, ignorant of the requirements of economic and material development. In the same way, development must be seen as a prerequisite of sustainable peace and a partner of responsible governments and civil society. Third, and closely related, these complex problems cannot be addressed effectively by the disciplines of the academy alone. As part of the mission of the part of its mission, the Keough School must help to foster collaborative partnerships between Notre Dame and other universities and colleges, and governmental agencies, non-governmental organizations, the networks and movements of civil society and the private sector. A fourth objective requires the direct and application of knowledge and research to real-world problems. The school must strengthen its peace, development, democracy, and human rights institutes and make available to leaders in the governmental, private, and nonprofit sectors the cultural knowledge and regional expertise of its Asian, Irish, and European institutes, as well as its considerable expertise in Latin America and growing sophistication in Africa. This Keough School must deepen Notre Dame's agility in policy studies and professional practice. Areas requiring new policy expertise include development, human rights, peace building, and global religion. The latter area, the study of religion's various roles in conflict, development, governance, and human rights, is a strength of Notre Dame and the Keough School. Expertise in this area is increasingly in demand across all global sectors. We need to develop more fully the range of policy implication of our insights into the global and local dynamics of religions. Fifth and finally, to address complicated development project problems, one partner cannot be neglected and must be centrally engaged, the local people and societies with whom Keough School students and faculty will work. These people are not clients, dependents, or recipients of development. For our efforts to be effective, they must be full partners. This commitment to an elicitive method of conducting Keough School research and practice is the fifth criterion implied by our decision to advance integral human development. If culture, religion, history, and personal subjectivity are to be taken seriously as essential expressions of human dignity and thus of effective human development, we must avoid a one-size-fits-all approach. This is not to deny that solutions to poverty, illness, and the like must be technical, empirically verified, and scalable. It is to insist that in devising such solutions, We must elicit cues, insights, proposals, and evaluations from the people most directly affected by the interventions. The work of development and peacebuilding cannot be for external actors alone. It must be fully owned by the local population. In his address to the UN, Pope Francis made this point forcefully. To enable these real men and women to escape from extreme poverty, we must allow them to be dignified agents of their own destiny. Integral human development and the full exercise of human dignity cannot be imposed. They must be built up and allowed to unfold for each individual, for every family, in communion with others, and in a right relationship with all those areas in which human social life develops: friends, communities, towns and cities, schools, businesses and unions, provinces, nations, etc. We drink, of course, not only from our own wells, but from the experience and wisdom accumulated by the great scholars and institutions that have been engaged in global and international studies and practice for many years now. Learning from other universities and schools is also a prerequisite for the pluralistic and collaborative approaches which Catholic social teaching demands. In each of these five areas I've mentioned, ethics must be a central consideration, what we might call situated ethics. How are decisions taken and consequences for human flourishing weighed within specific value contexts, whether those of a discipline, a global corporation, transnational church, or a local culture? Notre Dame must be an acknowledged leader in raising the ethical question and engaging the question of moral values in this challenging task of advancing integral human development. Speaking of the Keough School's goals and aspirations as I have, let me be clear that we are hardly the only normatively driven or ethically resolute voice in the conversation. Hardly. We stand on the shoulders not only of the great teachers of the church, but also of the great scientists, professors, and practitioners on all continents from all faith traditions and none. But we do belong in this conversation, and it is time for Notre Dame to develop more fully the profile and capacity of a truly great global university. I'm pleased now to welcome to the podium Bishop Marcelo, who will speak to us about the encyclical and the church's approach to sustainable development. Bishop Marcelo.
When I want to begin to thank the director. I don't know if the name is the rector here, but anyway, Jenkins, that he gave his first speech, and also the director of the new institute, the new Faculty of Global Affairs, that we, in these days, in this time we are in the inauguration, and also special Father Godi that take me yesterday at 4 o'clock this morning at the airport. Really, I am very happy. This is the second time that I come to this very important university that have many years, but also is one of the not too much Catholic university that have sciences. And this today is impossible to understand the modern world if we don't study sciences, and in our reflection are not present sciences. And this is just the new of the encyclical Laudato Si of Pope Francis. We can say that the encyclical is a new approach, a new consideration of the social doctrine of the church, because put in the same way of the human rights, of the common good of the human person, the question of the environment, integral environment, and put in the same statute, we can say, this very important concept that come in the end from our reflection of the nature, our reflection of the creation. And for this, we can say that the encyclica have three more important fonts. One is the faith, and the other is science, natural sciences and social sciences. And of course, we have also a philosophical reflection, moral, special moral reflection. But I want only to say two words of each one of these dimensions. I think the first consideration is the question of the air, and in this sense, the Pope followed Francis, Saint Francis. And in what sense? In the sense that all the creation, we say, all the nature is created by God and have an orientation to God. And if you read the text, really the Pope adopted the evolution, the idea of the evolution. And this is new in the documents of the Church. Of course, he quoted Thomas Aquinas many times, but in this idea. And normally our documents reflect the idea of creation in the traditional sense that all things come from God. But this encyclica is more in the sense that study the question of the reditus. All in the past we say reditus in Latin, all things go to God. And this go to God is some kind of assumption of the evolution. And this is new. And for this reason, he studied also the question of the creation, because the creation is made by God and go to God. And in this line, the second thing important for me is the assumption of the more important doctrines that come from science, natural sciences. And we can synthesize this to say, in the paragraph 23, but also the other paragraph, but this especially, that the human activity that use fossil material provoke this climate change, the global warming, and this is the real disaster. And the Pope quoted the community of sciences and agree with this. And we can say this is magisterium of the Church. Like the other things that the Pope, when the Pope adopted or the Pope assumed some thesis of philosophy, like for example, human person. The human person is not in the gospel. But we say that it is part of the doctrine of the Church. In the same way, the idea that the Pope take from science, that the integral environment and the respect of the nature, the develop of nature, but the develop according with his potentialities, is a new thing and is incorporated in the magisterium of the Church. And it's ordinary magisterium. I say this because there are people to say, oh, there's opinion of the Pope. No, it's not only opinion. The Pope writes an encyclical to say, this is my magisterium, not only opinion. And the other question is the question of social sciences. And the adoption that the Pope take of the social sciences is to say, the consequence of this is the growth of the poverty. And the people to suffer this is the poor people of the rich countries and the poor countries. And these are a very important consequence. And this is both doctrines come from the Academy of Science, of the Natural Science, the first one, and for the Academy of Social Science, the second one. And of course, all this is in a synthesis of a vision of theology and faith. And in this line, he adopted these ideas. The solution. is very important because the popes think that the human being are able to change things. We can change. And in this idea of change, he follow a very old idea of Paul VI, that in his encyclical about Populorum Progressio, he speak about the develop. But when the Pope, in his last speech to the Academy of Sciences, he say, look, we need to have in consideration the green movement, he say. And this is very important because this is to respect the nature. But in the other side, the scientists need, especially the Christian scientists, need to have trust in the providence of God that put in the nature the potentialities to be developed for the scientific people, but for all people, to the good of the people, and to the good also of the nature. This idea is the basis of the sustainable development that is in the end in the encyclical. And of course, we can say that we have a magic moment, because it's the first time in the last times that the spirit of the church and the spirit of the world that is represented by the United Nations has some kind of synergy. And for the people to believe, for me, is because all this spirit comes from the Holy Spirit. And we can say that today we have this synergy that also the rectors say, and this is a real very important thing. And I want to finish to say, but the motivation by the Pope is especially the Beatitudes of the Gospel. And this other idea of Matthew 25 that the Pope say is the protocol of the last judgment. That is to say that the thing that you do with the last one, you do for me, say Christ. And we can say that the Beatitudes, blessed are the poor people, blessed are the people to have a poor heart, blessed are the people to want to be the justice in the world, blessed are the people to suffer for the justice, blessed are the people to are operators of peace, make peace. And for these people, God offer three very important things. First of all is the possession of the earth. If the people to follow this blessed are able to have the possession of the earth. This is a paradox thing, because it's not the rich people. In the contrary of the thing that we can do, we can think, the real people to have the possibility to have the possession of the earth is the poor people. And also the God offer to these people that they can be cool and be loving of justice, and this is to say they can be a son of God by participation, and also they can see God, and this is the more important retribution that we can have. Thank you.
Thank you, Bishop Marcelo. Now we'll have Professor Sachs come to the podium. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to speak from here, if it's all right. First, I just want to be next to my friends, because it's a great privilege and a pleasure to be sitting among all of you. But second, I want you to remember one thing from my talk. I'm the economist on the panel, so I'll represent the economy. Now, I don't want you to remember that the economy is the center of all things, on this stage, quite the contrary. I want you to remember that the economy is surrounded. The economy needs to be surrounded by science and scientific realities, by ethics and faith, and on the outside by learning. Because if you let the economy roam free, like up at the podium, it can make a terrible mess. But if you keep the economy bounded, physically respecting what we call the planetary boundaries, the boundaries that keep us safe on the planet, and if you keep the economy bounded by moral principles, by the Beatitudes, by the idea that the poor come first, or the idea that property rights are part of a moral order, not inviolable, but as the church says, part of a universal destination of goods so that goods are for all people, for human well-being, then the economy can serve some very important purposes. And we need the educators on the outside of all of this, because without the continued reflection on these issues, we'll lose the track of what science needs to tell us, and we'll lose the capacity to adapt our philosophical or theological insights for our time. I think the mission of the Keough School is therefore essential. And I want to say that in a peculiar way, the economic part of this, at this point, may be the smallest part of the story, ironically. And that's because the result of 250 years of technological progress and economic development means that the economic parts of our story are probably the most solvable issues when it comes to fighting poverty or climate change or other issues. We don't fail to solve these problems because they're economically unsolvable. We fail to solve them because we're not trying to solve them. Let me just give you the most trivial illustration of this. It's a cartoon illustration, but it's actually got a deeper truth to it. There are a billion people who struggle for survival in what is called extreme poverty. Our world output, adding up what the United States, China, Europe, and the rest of the world produces, is on the order of $100 trillion per year now. That's a lot of money. If we took 1 trillion of that, which is 1% of our output, 1% of our annual output, and transferred it to that 1 billion people in extreme poverty, that would be $1,000 per person. In some arithmetic sense, it's the end of poverty before our eyes. That's almost how easy it is, actually. Maybe rather than giving money, you would build schools, clinics, roads, distributed solar power, safe water points. People would then have the means for escaping out of poverty on their own effort. But the cost is relatively, as I put it, maybe 1% of our annual production. Our problems in the world are not the lack of means. It's not that things are too expensive to do. It's that we don't try. We don't care. We're not organized. As Pope Francis said, because there is a globalization of indifference. So merely breaking through is extraordinarily difficult. You've no doubt watched the Republican debates. It's amazing. Every 2 weeks, they spend the time on nothing but how to end poverty, right? They spend those 2 hours on how they're going to get to grips with the environmental crisis, how to be kinder and fairer to people given this $100 trillion of income per year. We are seeing the real challenge in that we're not even discussing the real issues most of the time. We've lost the track. We don't even know necessarily what the issues are. And that's why these pivotal events that Dean Appleby started with at the beginning are so crucial, in my view, because they can draw attention and focus to what's important. I have been also saying all the time that we had three miracles this past year. I'll make it four now. My count was slightly false, but that's why you learn. You come to learn. We have great events that are helping us to draw attention to what can be done and what needs to be done. If you look at the challenges that we face, whether it's ending extreme poverty, saving millions of children's lives every year from death and disease of causes that are completely, totally preventable deaths, diseases that are easily cured when they're not prevented, where we could save 6 million children's lives every year that are dying now, where we could educate every child on the planet, everywhere, and give that child access, essentially for free, to 1 million publications at no extra marginal cost if we cared to do it, and where we could redirect the way we produce and use energy so that we could have the good life that we like and should like, by the way, because what has been achieved through economic development is quite marvelous in how it's given us longer lives, healthier lives, safety, the escape from the horrible plight of extreme poverty, of which 1/7 of humanity still suffers, but how we could do this safely and environmentally soundly. These events of last year, establishing shared global goals, of adopting remarkably a unanimous declaration, 196 signatory nations to fight climate change, and to have a unique call to action from Pope Francis is something that is so valuable and essential for us that we have to grasp the occasion. There will not be new global goals other than these 17 sustainable development goals for another generation. They took years to bring about. There will not be another climate agreement other than the Paris Climate Agreement for another generation, because it took literally 23 years from the signing of the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change in 1992 to reach an agreement on how to implement it in the year 2015. So we have a technical and economic feasibility that makes these problems absolutely manageable. We have a neglect that has brought us to the very edge of disaster. And we have, through enormous good fortune, the good fortune of Pope Francis, and the good fortune of a rare moment of global consensus on direction of sustainable development and climate, a sign of where to head. We have an accurate view of what needs to be done. The 17 Sustainable Development Goals that I'm sure you all know by heart, but just to refresh your memory, you'll go home, Google them, and know them absolutely by tomorrow morning's class. Because if you're in my class tomorrow morning, I'm going to ask you. Okay? And the Paris Climate Agreement are solid documents. And Laudato Si is not just solid, you would assign chapter 2 to any graduate class of ecology. It's luminous, it's wondrous. It gives us a spirit and a direction. So we have our work cut out for us. The Keough School will make a profound difference. You're coming at exactly the right moment. Because the idea of an integral approach to human problems, the idea of a school of international affairs, global affairs, that takes on the challenges, not only analytically, but morally and spiritually, and a great school like Notre Dame that is reaching out to the world for connections to turn the learning into results is exactly what we need. I couldn't be more thrilled to be here this evening. Thank you very much.
I'll do it from here, apologies. It's indeed a great pleasure to be here. The conference is on for the planet and the poor. And this is in the context of the encyclical letter by the Pope on care for our common home. And this home has been threatened from many sides. We cannot have a home where one third of our family is in poverty. No house would function if one third of its members were in abject poverty. Another one third is so well fed that they are suffering from obesity and malnutrition out of obesity. So there is something fundamentally that we have to think deeply how we overcome some of the crises we have. And the solution that has come over the period is what is now being called sustainable development. Many of us, not only on this podium, but many of you there and others have taken great care, made contribution to this concept coming up. Now, sustainable development is the concept of economic development, which is environmentally sound and socially just. Easy to define, hard to do. Because to do social justice in our social structure needs a lot of thinking, some sacrifice on part of some communities, people, vested interest, which often is very, very difficult to combine and gear up the whole issue. Socially just to be is one of the greatest challenges that we have. And it's about allocation of resources. Now, nature, creator, God, in whatever name we call the process that through which we have come, is a process in which sort of justice and allocation was built in. It is said by doctors that in mother's womb, a child across the world has more or less similar nutrition, if not identical amount of nutrition.
And my doctor friends have told me that even if the mother is dead and the child is alive, the child will get and suck out the nutrition of the mother as far as it can and come to the world. So there has been some justice out there. The moment the child is born, injustice begins. And what we could do as scientific modelers, we can chart out how much a child, depending on where he or she is born, will be consuming in the history of lifetime by modeling how much energy, how much food, what consumption level, how obese one would be at the end, or how much greenhouse gas one can emit across the course of life. So our society has a structured poverty. It is not given. We have created it as we went along. Time to correct it. And this is a great opportunity where convergence of various processes are taking place. This food, greenhouse gas, energy, water need, all that can be modeled, and that's not difficult. Most graduate students with a bit of computing knowledge can do that. Now, the history of the sustainable development was interesting. It started in the mid-80s, culminated in the Earth Charter 1992, the Rio de Janeiro Summit, the Earth Summit. And there, we had led a movement called Global Forum on Environment and Poverty. We said environmental solutions, which at that time there were three conventions, Climate Convention, the Biodiversity Convention, and the Desertification Convention. Desertification Convention was added later on, still doesn't have any money attached to it, so it's sort of hanging there. But the other two conventions have moved on, Climate Convention moved on very far, and has done a number of things, including the Kyoto Protocol, which the richest countries decided that we have agreed to everything, but it might be slightly uncomfortable, so we will not stick to it. We'll withdraw from it. And we have gone to the villages in Africa, in Latin America, in Asia, talking to people that if you commit yourself and then withdraw because it's not convenient, what do you call those people? And they don't say pretty names for those. I will not name them. So the Global Forum on Environment and Poverty demanded a poverty convention in 1992. We said, we want end of poverty. And any child being born poor must be able to sue somebody for being poor. Now that was a very loud message. And that time we were considered disturbing elements because we were, the process of the other conventions were being disrupted as tens of thousands of people in the Rio process were supporting this. Then there was a sort of informal deal made that we'll look into the issue of poverty reduction soon, and subsequently we'll get into the total poverty eradication in the subsequent phase. And this is what we are seeing now. MDG was halving the worst form of poverty. Sustainable Development Goal is trying to eradicate poverty. At that point in 1992, we did not dare use the word eradicate because that was too much for sensitivity of the then leadership and the generation. So in MDG, certain things have happened. Great knowledge has come out, quite a bit of success. Some countries have done better than others, but individual things have happened. Out of that came the right. The United Nations had given right to safe drinking water and sanitation and several other of those human requirements. Now, why does the convergence take place? There are three convergence steps, as Professor Sachs mentioned. The first one was the Sendai Conference on Natural Disasters and Disaster Management. Now, let us remember that climate change enhances most of the natural disasters, floods, cyclones, tornadoes, typhoons, whatever you call them, and floods, droughts across the world will be intensified severely by climate change. So those two had to be harmonized, and they have to be brought down. And this was done in Sendai first, and then subsequently the climate change convention in Paris that was mentioned, and sustainable development goals, the 17 goals from 2016 to 2030. So the climate convention is now a great success in terms of agreeing to do things, because we as a community of the planetary process are not known to have agreed to do things. There are more wars going on right now in whether it's Middle East or Africa or other places than ever before. May not be the big wars, but anyway, we are not agreed on many, many things. So the climate convention is a miracle in certain ways, but it's a framework. What it has got, it can be analyzed in many ways. There are two models, the way I look at it. One model is what I call jigsaw puzzle. There are various puzzles have been set up in different parts. The first 29 pages is the decisions, how to implement those, the convention, which is 12 pages. And so the agreement, 12-page agreement, will have to be given a structure. And this is the jigsaw. Various pieces of puzzles are there. There is a financing puzzle. There is an adaptation puzzle. There is a mitigation puzzle. There is ways of how to govern this process. So all those have to be fit in. And as we know, in a good jigsaw puzzle, if one doesn't fit, the rest doesn't fit. So we have to do it quite well. The other model is, it can be called the network model. As if it's a net, like a fishing net, where knots are there, but the inside is empty. We have to fill them up. We have to do them pretty fast. So we have the challenge in front of us. All the governments will have to agree to do that, because it's a consensus process of intergovernmental process. The intellectual, the academic world, the research community, the activist community, the NGOs, and even private sector, they can do their bit, but it's the intergovernmental process. All the government must agree. So that's where we are going with this trio of agreement. Fortunately, on top of that comes the encyclical letter in which Pope has given the spiritual and the value-based judgment that we must move forward and how to do that. And this is what makes the miracle, makes the consensus happen. The spiritual and religious convergence of the encyclical letter is a great one. Now, I feel that we have, you know, for the last 35 years, we have been working on various aspects of these, and I work a lot of my time these days on younger generation, working with them, trying to understand how to move forward on this. And the feeling I get is our generation, have created enough of this problem, analyzed them well, and give huge challenges, but not enough solutions to the younger generation who are looking for solutions. Solutions, things they can do, and they can solve the problem in their hand. But the problems have become so vast that we don't seem to get a handle. So SDGs gives us a handle of doing these things, and we have to do through the 17 SDGs that we've got, out of which number 13 is the climate change one. So the young generation must be given solutions to do things, and there has to be solutions across the board. The whole question of poverty, why poverty should be eliminated, is not for the poor alone. Poverty must be eliminated for the rich to function in a society that can function well. The poor, this billion poor people, if they're brought into the market They have, they develop purchasing power, they create the economy moving, they do wonderful things, and they are creative. What a waste of human ingenuity and efforts by not bringing this billion into the production process, in our contribution process to our society. So it is for the rich that poor has to be there, because the rich then sell their products to these poor coming out people. And the poor has been efficient. If all the poor was as rich as, say, Middle America or Europe, mid of Europe, then the greenhouse gas would have shot up, and the number of droughts and cyclones and floods would have tripled by now. So they have been efficient in resource management. We must, the rich must be humble about that, the contribution that the poor have made, so that they can have a good time. They had their good time, they can have better time by bringing the poor up. So it's in mutual interest that this must be done. And help them to do their creativity. In terms of climate change, the global system had agreed to the Kyoto Protocol. And we have learned a few lessons from Kyoto Protocol. Unfortunately, there has been disjointed. We have to start all over again, create that sort of exchange mechanism. And most of the governments of the rich countries are saying, the private sector must be coming to solve the problem. And the private sector said, of course we will solve the problem. Give us about 18% internal rate of return and give us the profit, and we'll solve every problem. But that profit who is going to give? So it has to be an integrated system where we have to work together with the government and the private sector. Now, having missed the opportunity of mitigation, which is to reduce the greenhouse gas that we promised in Kyoto Protocol, or even doing more than that, what we did, we created need for greater amount of adaptation, which is the poor particularly, who are vulnerable, have to adapt. In Bangladesh coast, people are being inundated with salt water because it's a flat area. A little increase in the sea level is a huge ingress of salt water. And one of the reasons why where science doesn't communicate that well, and I have no hesitation in saying the scientists are not greatest communicators anywhere for the communities and people, but the failure is that it is not the extreme, it is not the mean, it's not 2 degrees centigrade, it's not 18 centimeters of sea level rise, it is the extremes that will dominate the process of reality and experience of discomfort for the population at large across the world. By extremes, is the lunar tide that makes the sea level rise, so it is for 3 days of the month that brings salt water inside the home. So ordinary people have to raise their homes. There is no government, no NGOs, no private sector for these people. If people, their bare hands, an ocean in front of them, full of salt water coming in. And they raise it themselves. The amount of money the poor have spent in handling, already spent in handling climate change by raising their plinth, by tribes in Africa or Sahel not finding the oasis that their animals used to have because they have dried out. If you calculate all that together, the poor's contribution to climate change has crossed $100 billion per year, which is what the all rich countries hope to pay when they are willing to pay. They're supposed to start paying around 2012. That has been postponed now to 2020 has moved and 2025 now, which means the value of that amount of $100 billion has already halved. I'm not saying that the rich have cheated, but that's the game. The economist will tell me better how that value has been degraded. So the poor are paying Time has come, the rich must pay. Poor are paying with their lives, the rich must pay with the resources that have been happening. If we don't, then what will happen is there will be much bigger climate-induced migration. An Intergovernment Panel of Climate Change says by end of this century, it will be 300 million people who will have to migrate. Now, our calculations show it will be much earlier than that, will be 2075. By about 2030, we'll start seeing the visibility of that. Now, a bit of migration happening in Europe right now isn't really putting a lot of pressure on Europe and everybody else. And suddenly, doors are being shut up. We hear the walls will come up, and a lot of other things will happen because migration is such a future. When 300 million people come, that is a world that we don't want to contemplate. The action on climate change today should have begun yesterday, yesteryears, yesterdecade, for our own interest, for our own protection. Otherwise, Europe will look like child play. Second World War will look like not a very violent world. But we are moving into that world, so we have to be very cautious. So the world of the future we must take in our hand, and SDG gives us an opportunity to do that, to pull that together. In where I work in Bangladesh, in the Bangladesh Center for Advanced Studies, we're working on many of these issues from the poor's perspective, people's perspective, community level activities. And I'll just share two experiences with you that just shows that how we things can happen positively. One is we are holding for last, from 2005 onward, for 11, 12 years now, 10 world conferences on community-based adaptation, adaptation that ordinary people, communities are doing themselves. And to understand the science of it, to understand how these mechanics work, to understand how people get together, how they manage themselves, their own communities, etc. And that is happening across the world, among the communities. So nobody is sitting idle. They're trying their best. Science is not that clear, but it's emerging. The scientists, the activists, the practitioners, the researchers, the policy community, all of them are working and participate, anything between 250 to 400 scientists get together, discuss. And one of the first things we do in these conferences is the first 3 days, people are, the participants are encouraged to go to field visits and see how the communities are working. Now this, in my experience of the last 10, 11 years, is a very humbling exercise for the scientists and the practitioners and the big policymakers. When they go to the field, they realize people are doing a lot, much more than they think is happening, because they're trying their best, they're doing it for their survival, they're finding innovative techniques, not ideal. In an imperfect world, you need semi-imperfect solution. You won't get the perfect solutions. So a lot of those solutions are happening, and one of these experiences is last year, year before last, the 8th World Conference on Community-Based Adaptation was held in Kathmandu. There was a Kathmandu Declaration which says that of all the money spent in climate change, 50% must be spent on adaptation, because that's where the poor are facing. At this point, in the UN jargon, this is called balanced distribution, which is 16% on adaptation, 86% of mitigation. That's what our governments call balanced distribution. So we said, no, 50-50 is the minimum balance that must be there. So the present fund that has been created, the Green Climate Fund, has accepted that as a principle coming out from the communities. So there are progresses being made. And of course, they have about $13 billion now out of the $100 billion that will have to be coming. So a number of things, the science is emerging, various other things, we are learning from each other, and this mutual learning is the way forward, and here is school, here is moving towards that, to learn from each other in making a world that can really take us further. The other experience that I'll share with you is the experience of solar energy at the household level that we have done in Bangladesh. My organization was involved with an aided project, a small project by the government of Bangladesh with a foreign country. And the project has started. We started seeing how solar energy could be used by the poor, how they can be integrated in the poor household, houses which in the next 20, 30 years will not get grid level electricity. How do you take light to them, energy to them, and allow them to function? And we started doing the typical pilot project first in an isolated island. And within 2 years, the project ended. Once the project ended, government packed up, the donors packed up, the technologists left, and we are left there. I said, we haven't learned enough. How will the poor work with this? This is a technology that we don't know. There are things will break down, lights will break, the bulbs will break down. How do you do that? Flood will come. If it is underwater, how will you go to function? So after a lot of heartache, we decided for 5 years, we are going to learn from the communities how to manage it, how to do it better. So 5 years we went and learned from there. And having learned it, then we developed all the mechanisms and took it to the market intermediaries, because these households were mostly for the poor, and poor are saturated with risk already. And our development expert told us, do not add any more risk to the poor with technology until unless. So it is the responsibility of the scientist, up to the community experts, of the international community and national government, to make sure you don't add risks to the poor's life. And you sort out the basic technology beyond reasonable doubt that functions. So we did that 5 years, no funding, nothing from our own resources. And after that, we handed it over to the market intermediaries who have started slowly moving, and we were not sure how it was going to work. Fortunately, I can report that by now, 4.5 million poor households have accepted and taken and bought solar home systems in their house, and they get about 4 to 5 hours of lighting in the evening, and they're now charging their cell phone batteries. They're doing a lot of other activities. Children are going to schools, being able to do their homework, etc. So the whole development process starts. So through these two examples, all I want to say, things can be done. If we have put our mind to it, knowledge, goodwill, and these values that Pope has so well articulated and wanted us to move forward. So it's not a price-based world that we have to only do. Of course, commodities have prices. But it's the values behind those that we have to inculcate. And I hope our SDG goals, our climate solutions, will take us there. If we miss these particular climate, we may not have the world that we really want to live in and live in for our next generation. So it's that responsibility that we have to all work together. I wish Keough School all their best in their new venture. And as I agree with Jeffrey Sachs, that this is the right time. Timing is excellent. We, whatever within our capacity, we will work and cooperate with you. And you must define, you are on the driving seat, but we'll be on the car with you all the way and see how we work together. So that is the way we move forward. Institutionalization is the best way of taking steps and taking this further. Of course, the governments will make the major decisions. We hope we get our best leaders that we deserve, not the leaders who talk the most, but the way that we can move forward. Thank you.
Tough acts to follow, I'll say. I guess I would conclude the panel by just adding a sense of urgency to what we've heard our panelists discuss tonight. Urgency for a number of reasons.
Okay.
For starters, this really is, as the bishop eloquently explained to us, a magic moment. It's just not going to be the case that every year is going to be like 2015. We are not going to have major papal encyclicals that unite so many different constituencies. I would note that he articulated in the encyclical that it was written to the people of the world, and I think the people of the world took it that way, which is not always the case. I have had more colleagues who've had probably no experience reading papal encyclicals in their life write articles on this one than I can begin to count. It's really struck a nerve of truth and meaning in the hearts and minds of people of goodwill across the world. That won't happen every year. We are certainly, as Jeff pointed out, we're not going to have another batch of goals that are this ambitious and this unanimously supported by the nation states of the country every year. It's not going to happen. And it's certainly not going to be the case that in the same year we're going to have major agreements on the climate that, frankly, many people thought were not possible to achieve. The challenge with having a magic moment is if you don't take advantage of it, it vanishes. And that's the danger. And these agreements are actually astounding. I mean, many people would never have predicted that we could have gotten any of the three of them, let alone all of the three of these major works together collectively. And if that's not enough to provoke the kind of action that is going to require to have these documents bring real meaning and real change in real people's lives, it's really hard to imagine what we as a collective human community could do that would. So I think the magic moment is actually a bit intimidating. And if you don't feel intimidated, you should, actually. You really should. Let me quote the encyclical for you. He says, our goal, he says, is to become painfully aware, to dare to turn what is happening to the world into our own personal suffering, and thus to discover what each of us can do about it. Another reason that I want to express a sense of urgency is because of a phenomenon that the Pope refers to as rapidification, a beautiful word. But that basically, there are massive things going on in the world, natural forces that are going to happen whether we decide we want to try to be a part of them or not explicitly. They are happening. There are $100 trillion of income that Jeff mentioned that this world produces every year. What he didn't mention is that when I took his class, that number was less than half that amount. Let me just repeat that. What the economy has figured out how to deliver from the dawn of time till when I took Jeff Sachs's class, which I'm not going to tell you how long ago it was, but it was not close to the dawn of time, I will tell you that, is basically half. And the other half, since I took his class, what's going to happen in the next 10 years, the next 20 years? The economy's actually really done its job.
Yeah.
It's done its job. It is delivering vast amounts of wealth. Let's just be clear. This problem of inequality is a new problem in historic terms. It's a very new problem. We would have, all of us, all, unless you would have happened to have been the king. I don't know if we have any kings or queens in our midst. But if you weren't that, we were all desperately poor. The entire world was living on $1.25 a day from the dawn of time until the Industrial Revolution. And then we figured out how to make money. We figured out how to grow wealth. And that's a terrific thing. Per capita GDP, for it went from this sort of $1.25 a day, which is still true for 1 billion people, but it's not true for 6.5 billion people. When my grandmother was born, I like to talk in units of Irish stats because she lived to be just over 100, so it's kind of a nice unit of measure. When my grandmother was born in the United States, the per capita GDP was around $5,000 held in constant dollars, right? So $5,000 per person per year. By the end of the century, it was 10 times that. So these forces of economic growth that we're talking about have taken off in the United States. There's some debate about whether this is going to go back down. Actually, an interesting debate that's emerged about whether it's going to be sustainable in this country or not. But what we do know is it's spreading to other places. So that's happening whether we like it or not. The impact that that kind of activity and the growth of all sorts of things that, that are associated with it, that's impacting this earth. And it's impacting in this earth in ways, some of which we understand, most of which we probably actually still don't, to be clear. I mean, this is where we know a lot. But the impact of half of the world's production coming in the last 20 years, of course she's groaning. What were we expecting? So the fact that all of these forces are happening, and I just gave the example of the economy, we could pick many, many other things, that's a phenomenon that's going on. The question is whether we're going to try to harness it for the public good or not. And the Pope has something to say about this as well. He says, the goals of this rapid and constant change are not necessarily geared to the common good or to integral and sustainable human development. They're forces. But what we have from the encyclical and from the spirit with which it was given, regardless of one's personal beliefs, the spirit with which this was given is profound for all of us to consider. Because it's essentially saying it is each of our moral responsibility to understand these forces, to understand the impact on the most vulnerable that these forces are having, and to identify ways that we as individuals and as collectives can try to promote integral human development and the principles that were so eloquently described by our dean. I love the example that Atiq gave us of electrification in Bangladesh. Because the third reason I think there's a sense of urgency is you would be amazed at what's possible to get done. It's truly mind-blowing. I mean, let's just pause for a moment and think about what you said. Bangladesh, 160 million people. We don't think of Bangladesh as necessarily being on the cutting edge of making sure that there's good social delivery to all people in all ways all the time. For a country like Bangladesh to be able to get rural electrification sustainably done in such a short period of time, we happened to be actually in the office of the, of the agency within the parastatal and governments responsible for this. They tell us they're going to be at 100% electrification between an extension of the grid and an expansion of this system within the next 5 years. Unbelievable. That the technology exists, that you figured out how to work with the communities, thank you very much, we tipped the hat. That's an inspiration for countries like Nigeria, where it's 25% electrification, more or less. That's a somewhat made up number, but roughly right. For all of us, actually, that's only one example. We could go on, and we heard a list. In the introductions, we heard a list of the many, many different ways in which this earth was changed and the people's lives on it was changed by actions taken by people on the panel. So if we have the opportunity that's a historic moment, and we have an urgency, because like it or not, this world is going to change a lot because of rapidification, and it's either going to change in a direction where we try to do something about it and succeed, or where we let things run amok and deal with probably some sort of dystopic consequence. And it's possible to get all these things done, or many of these things done. The child mortality rate remains stubbornly high, but I worked in Nigeria. Let's just be clear, not an easy country to work in on most dimensions. During the 7 years that I worked in Nigeria, the child under 5 mortality rate dropped from 212 per 1,000 to under 100. Now, under 100 is still too high, but it's a whole lot better than 212. That's hundreds of thousands of kids that just didn't die because of steps that government took. Now, it's always dangerous to talk about the theology of situations, and I particularly feel at Notre Dame terribly intimidated to talk about the theology of situations. But I would like to just close by reflecting a moment on a trip that I took to Swaziland about 10 years ago when we were in the midst of the AIDS orphans crisis. I was working for Jeff, and he graciously allowed me my obsession, supported by Columbia, to go out and work to try to see what we could do about the AIDS orphans crisis. Orphans and vulnerable children, they're different. There was at the time a deep concern that there would be massive numbers of kids that would be orphaned due to HIV. We had projections that were truly horrifying. Growing up without parents looking out for you is a pretty horrific thing. What was even more horrific is the collective impact of that disease was wiping out enough of the working age, parent age people, adult population, that the traditional systems of absorption of orphans, which are very robust actually through most cultures in the parts of Africa that were affected, those systems were breaking down under the sheer weight of the need. Swaziland was one of the places that was worst hit, and we took a trip there, my colleagues and I, and we were wandering around, and it's a middle-income country, not the poorest country, very hard hit by HIV, about a 40% rate of HIV positive. And we wandered into this this woman's house, and she was an older woman, and there was, I felt like we'd met the old woman who lived in the shoe, who had so many children, she didn't know what to do. She was a grandmother, and she had five children, who had, four of whom had died, she said, of AIDS. It sounded, the wasting disease, it sounded like AIDS, but anyway, gone. And the fifth had left and abandoned the kids. And there, I counted 18. I don't know how many kids there actually were, but they were just coming in and out of this little house. And you saw as the kids got younger, they got sicker. They weren't getting enough food. It's pretty clear they weren't getting enough. And how this woman was supposed to meant to be providing for them, you know, who knows? So we asked her. We said, what are you going to do? How do you take care of all these kids? And she said, God will provide. Now I looked at the little ones. And I was like, not well, though, really. I mean, this doesn't look like providing. And we said, well, you know, what if that, you know, do you have a plan other than that? And she just looked up and she said, God will provide. We kind of looked at each other. And, you know, I will say that it's very hard to leave a house like that in a situation like that and do nothing. So we took everything we had, basically, and we gave it to her and said, you know, take care of the kids. And she smiled at us and she said, see, God provided. Theology department. Go to the theology panel. Please explain what that means. I don't know. Oh. In any case, I think we can do better than that, actually. And in Swaziland, we had with us, as it happens, the former finance minister who was in charge of the National AIDS Response Team, who hadn't really seen what was going on with the orphans crisis and these grannies prior to that visit. So he was sort of astounded. And then he sort of reflected on seeing orphans sort of wandering by the side of the road. And he stopped and asked one what had happened. And they said, well, we heard our parents died, and we heard that we have a granny, you know, seven villages over. So we're walking for a couple of days to see if that's true. I mean, really pretty desperate circumstances. And at the time, the Global Fund, which Jeff was instrumental in creating, did not allow a funding stream, nor did PEPFAR, did not allow a funding stream to help for the care of these children who've been orphaned by this disease. And Swaziland ended up being, and we worked with them very, very significantly on the proposal, Swaziland ended up being one of the first countries to apply to the Global Fund for support for these grannies to take care of what this woman was doing, inspired by her, really, to tell you the truth. And by the next year, 20,000 grants to grannies in Swaziland was provided by the Global Fund. And with a population of 1 million people, by the time you do the math, that's actually a significant dent in the overall problem, right? So I'm always inspired, scared, intrigued by this crazy world that we live in that's changing unbelievably quickly, and disheartened sometimes by some of the suffering that we see, having the same question that I think we all have, why does God allow these things to happen? Why do we allow these things to happen when they're things that we know we can do? And I actually asked Archbishop Tutu at one point, and he looked at me and he said, I don't know what those answers are, Sarah, but I know my job is to wipe away God's tears. And I think that's all of our jobs. And I certainly hope that the Keough School will be the place that it can be, if we decide it is going to be the place we want it to be, that institutionally wipes away God's tears.
Thank you.
Okay, we have two very brief things left to do. The first is to for me to say just a word about this conference that we've just opened. First, you've received, there's so many problems and challenges you've heard about that it's been necessary to give you five keynotes in one. So please join me in thanking the panel for framing the conversation for the next couple of days very well. Which is to say that the goal tonight, as I think you've inferred, was to set kind of a broad framework and look at the range of issues that we'll be discussing in more detail in several panels, all of which will be held at the Hesburgh Center for International Studies in the auditorium there over the next 2 days, where we look at specific issues in more detail that have been raised tonight on economic development and global health and faith-based solutions and a variety of specific topics in which you'll have a chance to interact with the panelists tonight and with many other distinguished guests who have expertise in these various areas. So I encourage you to attend those panels. The second thing to do is to put our three guests on the spot in two ways before we adjourn. I'm not going to ask Sara to answer this question because she answers it for me every day. The question is, and you have 1 minute only to answer it, because it's been a long day, long panel, and you'll have a chance to engage people if you come to the various sessions. So we're not going to take questions tonight. But the question is this, 1 minute, what's the one thing that the Keough School, New School of Global Affairs, in your opinion, needs to contribute to this task of advancing integral and sustainable human development? What should we contribute? Many things, of course, but you only can answer with one, and in 1 minute, and you've got to justify that answer, because we have all kinds of people out here ready to act on what you say. So I'm going to start with the man in the center, who put himself right in the center, the economist, with everyone on various sides. That's by way of giving the other two gentlemen a moment to think while Jeff is ready with his answer.
I thought I would end with a little parable of a plane, actually, that comes to a screeching halt. And when the passengers are getting out, they look in the cockpit and they see that the pilot is blind with a cane. This is horrifying. One of them sticks his head in the cockpit and says, you're a blind pilot, what are you doing? He said, well, it's really no problem to fly this. You know, all along the route, I'm on autopilot anyway. And then I get beamed in for the landing. And the plane touches down automatically. The only thing I don't know is, you know, how far to roll to the gate. And as I'm just rolling along, suddenly people start screaming in the back, stop it, you're going to kill us all. And then I pull up the brakes. That's a little like we are right now. So the pilot and the plane is pretty good. But we don't know where to put on the brakes. We don't know where to apply the knowledge. And if the Keough School focuses on the problems of safe landings, keeps its eye on the crucial transitions that are needed, we'll be discussing them in the next 2 days. An energy transition, help for the extreme poor, protecting biodiversity, managing cities that become the center of almost all human settlements in this century, assuring that every child gets a healthy start, and works in very practical ways, but also with the motivation that we've talked about to solve these problems. That is the role of the Keough School. And keep the focus on the problem. The disciplines will have to come together in new ways. The partnerships will have to form in new ways. But if you keep your eye on the problem to be solved, that safe landing, you're sure to find some real solutions.
Bishop Marcelo.
I think that we can synthesize to say develop is the new name of justice, and justice is the name of peace. Justice, justice, and justice.
Okay. It's to get to that justice, we have to ensure security. So I would say food security, energy security, water security, livelihood security, climate security. We should work on those to make that every citizen on this planet is secure. And that's a very tall order for any single institute. But the contribution that you can make to take us there or give some guidance, because the older institutions have so bogged in their own history that we do really need new thinking in taking this forward. And those securities, once you start looking at it, will lead us to many of these reinforcing challenges that we have. And poverty alleviation, elimination, eradication would be central to all those. But for that, you need to develop working across institutions in developing countries, the right ones, and so that at least kick off, start off, which other new institutions can come and follow.
So bring various disciplines and partners together to focus on the problem, keep the focus on the problem. The problems will change, but we keep the focus. We have to be considerate of security concerns across the board of various kinds in this kind of collaboration, in the developed food security, human security, a variety. And then just the little business of pursuing justice with a capital J. So I would say that if the Keough School can begin to realize just a little piece of this advice, it will be a world historical event to found the Keough School. You're all implicated in this effort who are here tonight, and so I thank you for being here, and let's once again thank our esteemed panelists.